One of the most important functions of a landfill is to manage its hydrology. So we want to protect the groundwater around or under the landfill, the surface water around the landfill, as well as minimize the amount of leachate that's going into the landfill and being formed. So there's quite a bit to the science of hydrology around landfills. In this lecture, we'll look at what are those flows and what are different factors that affect each. And in lab number two, you'll get right in and model some of these things and see what levers you have as a landfill designer to manage the hydrology around your landfill. This figure is showing the important hydrological flows around a landfill. So we've got precipitation, which is adding our new water, evapotranspiration, which can be removing water from the cover system, runoff off the cover of the landfill, surface water could be coming into the landfill from nearby surface water body. Inside the landfill itself, there's a certain amount of storage. Part of that comes from the moisture content at placement of the waste itself. And then part of it is material that got, or water that got into the landfill after it was placed. So infiltration would be anything that comes through the final cover system and is stored in the waste. Then if we go over the storage capacity, we're going to be producing leachate, which is going to come out to our leachate collection system. We might have some getting actually through the liner system and out of the landfill, we call percolation. Then we've got groundwater, which could be coming, you know, into the landfill as well as that percolation coming out. So there's all these different interactions that we want to manage in different ways, whether it's minimizing or maximizing. To model this mathematically, the storage, so the amount of water in the landfill, we can construct a differential equation around it. So the change in storage is just the amount that's added or taken away from the landfill. And things that add to the water are the precipitation coming onto the landfill, groundwater flowing into the landfill, or surface water flowing into the landfill. And what takes away from that is runoff coming off the landfill, evapotranspiration coming off the landfill, leachate being removed, percolation going out of the landfill. And then our storage term at zero would be equal to that moisture content at placement. And over time, all those flows will contribute to the storage. If we just want to look at the surface, then we can break out that infiltration term, which is kind of an intermediate. It doesn't show up in the first equation, but it would just be equal to the precipitation coming in minus the runoff and the evapotranspiration. Anything that's not running off or evapotranspirating has to be going into the landfill. Understanding those flows around our landfill, our main objectives or why we want to control each of these are one, to prevent seepage from the cover. So that's water bursting out of the side and getting back into our surface water. We want percolation from the liner to be minimized. So that's shown in the picture on this slide, this plume that's coming out of the landfill going into the water. We don't want that to happen. And we also want to control the biological processes inside the reactor. So thinking back to our dry tomb versus bioreactors, we either want to keep it as dry as possible or keep it at the optimal moisture for our bioreaction to continue. So next slides, we'll go through each term of that water balance equation and talk about each. So the leachate term, any water that comes out of the waste or has touched the waste, we call leachate. A primary leachate was buried with the waste, and then a secondary leachate is from precipitation or another water source that gets added to the waste after it's there. So secondary leachate is typically much, much greater than primary leachate. Out of the total leachate volume, most of it was not buried with the waste. It comes in from outside. And that's thinking back to the construction, the importance of doing the design and construction and operations to try and close it as quickly as possible and keep as much water out as you can to reduce that secondary leachate production. The graph on the side here just visually shows an example of what the leachate production profile is like. And you can see almost all of the secondary leachate production is during this active filling phase. And while the cell is closed, it's much, much, much smaller. So making this active filling phase as short as possible is the most important factor for minimizing secondary leachate quantity. Our next set of letters in our formula is evapotranspiration. So evapotranspiration is just evaporation plus transpiration. Evaporation being that physical movement of water from a liquid state to a vapor state, just by evaporation, and then transpiration happening by plants. So water being taken up by the roots and then transpired from the leaves. So both of these just result in a net change of liquid water in the ground or on the ground to vapor in the air that's out of our balance. When we talk about modeling evapotranspiration, there's two types: potential and actual evapotranspiration. Potential evapotranspiration being the amount of transpiration that could happen provided there was enough water there. So potential evapotranspiration is limited by the amount of energy for evaporating that water, whereas actual evapotranspiration is what is actually removed. So once the water dries up, then even if there's potential to remove more, it doesn't actually happen. So actual evapotranspiration is water limited. And that means actual evapotranspiration is always less than the potential. If you had the highest AET you can have is equal to the PET. And evapotranspiration is affected by many things, and you'll be familiar with these as you go through lab two. So there's the evaporative zone depth. So the deeper the roots go, then the more water they can pull out of that system and put in the atmosphere. The leaf area index, so that just measures how densely an area is covered. So if you were to look straight down at an area, how many leaves would you go through? That's measuring the leaf area index. So the more vegetation, then the more transpiration will happen. There's the length of the growing season. So how long of the year are we having this nice warm sunlight evaporating and supporting these plants during transpiration? Wind speed and humidity. So how much gradient do we actually have between the moisture in the air and the ground to actually remove it? So there's quite a bit to modeling the evapotranspiration. Our next variable we'll look at is surface water. And this is closely related to runoff, so the next two slides will kind of blur together. But with our surface water, we want to do two things: prevent our landfill from busting out and getting into the surface water, as well as preventing the surface water from flowing into their system and ending up turning into leachate. And there's all types of structures that can be used to manage the surface water. So there's the final cover system of the landfill itself, which should keep the leachate inside the landfill, as well as all the kind of traditional pieces of surface water infrastructure that you'd see on any site: ditches, drains, berms, channels, swales, drainage blankets, all these different things to help move surface water away from where we don't want it and then into places we do want it. And as you'd see with other sites, stormwater management systems or surface water management is governed by the ECA for that site. Next, we have runoff. Runoff is really just a kind of surface water, so we define it as any precipitation coming onto the landfill and then rolling off of the cover, and then it will end up in one of those other surface water management systems. So if you think intuitively of, if you're a water droplet, do you want to go into the soil or off the soil? Those are all the things that are important when you're thinking about runoff. So the slope, how hard the surface is, how permeable, whether there's plants on it, stuff like that. Because there's so many factors involved, when modeling, you try and simplify. In HELP model, this is done with the Soil Conservation Service SES runoff curve number, which is a scale between 30 and 100, which lumps some of those parameters in together to try and give you an idea of, if you're a water droplet, are you going to go into the soil or run off the soil? And on the picture over here, you can see some channels developing on a landfill surface from the runoff. So the more the runoff that happens, the more cover it will actually carry away with it. And then there's kind of like a positive feedback loop there. So part of the final cover design is, you know, to allow the runoff, but also to maintain its integrity while there's material running off over it. The table below shows some SES curve numbers for different surfaces. So a really, really high curve number would be like a pavement or rooftop. So basically everything's running off. A really, really low number is like a meadow. So it's nice, flat, grassy, really invites the material to come in. So, you know, landfills, we want to behave, you know, from a surface water perspective, we don't want runoff. From a landfill perspective, We don't want water coming into the landfill. So we're trying to balance both of those things as surface water engineers at landfills, kind of managing those peaks and runoff, managing that really high storm flow to prevent things like this erosion, to prevent things like our stormwater management ponds from overflowing. But we also don't want to rely on the cover to store too much water because we don't want to risk too much water getting into our landfill. So it's pretty tricky. You'll get to play with some of these parameters when you do your model.